Okay, where do morals come from? First off, let's start with what is morality? And the Oxford English Dictionary says principles concerning the distinction between right and wrong or good and bad behavior. So really it's quite simple. Let's not overcomplicate this. It's really all about, you know, if you ask a question, what's the right or wrong thing to do here, or the good or bad, that's morality. That's what morality is. And I think Ben and I have common ground on that. I think we both agree that's a good definition for morality. Now the next question is where we differ is you say, what is right, what is wrong? You know, what is that? And my answer is, it's pretty simple. It's just that right and good are things that lead to flourishing and pleasure, and wrong or bad are things that lead to pain. So if you're going to do things that increase the pain in the world, essentially that's bad, that's wrong. And if you do things that are good to make people flourish, and by flourish I mean, imagine a test tube of little bacteria. If you do something to this test tube, like put in certain nutrients, they flourish when they get the right stuff they want, you know, the right sunlight, the right food, whatever. And if you put something toxic in there, they're going to die. So by flourishing, I just mean well-being, things that make us have the best possible life. So what does Ben think right and wrong simply means? This is something where I don't think he really has a clear definition. I think he thinks right and wrong basically is right is what God commands and wrong is what is against his commands, and you don't really have a, you can't really judge for yourself what's right or wrong. So that's one thing I hope to clarify later with Ben. So how do we know, how can we decide if there's a moral question, how do we know what's right or wrong? What kind of principles? And I have three principles that I think that are good for logically thinking about this. Reciprocity, which is treating others as you want to be treated yourself. And the reason for these three, by the way, is because these have shown to work. They're successful at what they do to show that it's the best way to reach human flourishing. So the first one is reciprocity. The next one is consequentialism, where you look at your potential behaviors and see what the outcomes might be. Based on that, you would pick out which you think is the best behavior. And the third thing is individual rights, which basically is boiled down to, as long as you don't hurt anybody else, it's basically okay. So some moral issues, they tie in all three of these. Some of them just hit one of these. Some of them, like rape, you know, they kind of like violate every one of them. That's why it seems so obvious to be a bad thing. Now, a good way that I think to explain this is consider it a map. A map, for example, let's say I want to go to the store from here. What's the best way to get to the store? There's some directions that are directly to the store. Those are the good directions. Some of them might go in the opposite direction. That's the worst possible direction. And so morals are the same thing, except for how to get to it. Instead of how to get to a place, you say how do you get to a designation that's a more of a society thing. So for example, let's say we don't want any starving children in the world, or we don't want children in pain, or children that are ignorant. We want to educate them. So how do you best do that? You build a path to that. You know, maybe it's good to have a law that they must be in school. You know, that's a moral issue. Now, an immoral issue might be to go the opposite way and say like, oh, well, don't teach kids anything. In fact, punish them if you find them trying to read a book. You know, so those are the evil things. They're going just the opposite direction and doing more harm. By the way, Christopher Hitchens said evil is basically like doing bad on stilts. So like if you mug somebody, that's bad. But evil is when you mug them and then you just stab them 100 times and kick them while they're down and, you know, abuse their body and just go overboard, you know. So I like that definition of good and evil. Evil anyway. And Ben said, well, what about oughtness? You have no moral weight for that. Well, oughtness is just what you ought to do to get there. So if I want to go to Safeway, I ought to take this path to get there the best way. In the same way, if I want to feed children or reduce suffering for children, this is what I ought to do. It's really not a mystery how you get an ought. It's just simply the best way to get to that path. One philosophical tool that people use is the veil of ignorance. And you know, in a children's example, this is what a lot of people experience in their homes. Let's say there's one piece of pie, and so the parent might say, okay, these two kids are fighting over this piece of pie. So one kid can cut the pie, the other kid will choose. And that, of course, the first kid, because he doesn't know which one the other kid's going to choose, it's called the veil of ignorance, where he has to make it fair because he doesn't want to get ripped off. So, for example, tax rates. What are the best tax rates? Should we tax the poor or not? Well, you use the veil of ignorance, pretend like you don't know the future for yourself. You might be a handicapped person for the next 30 years in your life with no income, or you might win the lottery tomorrow and have $10 million. What do you think is the best tax rate with this veil of ignorance, not knowing how you're going to be? Now, one of the problems with saying morality comes from God is that there's a lot of gross morality in the Bible supposedly coming from God. For example, in Deuteronomy 22, it says, if you suspect a woman is a non-virgin on her wedding night, you should kill her. Now, obviously, that's not worthy of the death penalty, and I can't imagine a father killing his daughter for something like that, because I have a daughter. And then there's the Noah's Ark story. I know Ben believes that there really was a Noah's Ark in a local area that killed all the humans except for the eight that were on the Ark. Well, that's worse than genocide. I mean, there's never been a genocide that major before if that were really to happen. And what did it accomplish? I mean, humans haven't really changed. So what is that? Just God throwing a temper tantrum? And another thing is that they say, well, we inherited sin because of Adam's sin. Well, that's not very just. That's not fair. Actually, the Bible has contradictory statements where in one place it might say the children have to pay for the sins of their fathers, and then another one, there's another verse where it says they will not. So there's contradictory messages there. And then, you know, just to go right at the throat of the gospel, I mean, the whole gospel doesn't make sense because Jesus is supposed to die a substitutionary death on our behalf. Well, how does that make sense if I kill somebody and somebody says, okay, well, instead of Bernie getting the death penalty, let me die for him? That's not justice. That's a perversion of justice. And that's just on top of the whole thing not making sense because God sacrificed his son. And, you know, in the Bible, it talks about God condemns child sacrifice in Jeremiah 7:31. He said, that's something that never entered my mind. And yet, he commanded Abraham to sacrifice his own son, Isaac. And Jesus is said to be God's son, sacrificed for sin. And this was all planned from the foundation of the world, according to Revelation. So, you know, on the one hand, God says, I would never do such a gross thing. And another, on the other hand, it's like, that's the core of the gospel, is that he sacrificed his own son, which is also himself. And he's a God. Gods are immortal, but he died on the cross. I mean, all this stuff is just nonsense on top of nonsense. One time I was in a debate and I asked, a Christian said, we can be thankful to God for everything. I said, even hell? He goes, yeah, even hell. And it's like, how could you be thankful for hell? Because, I mean, if you were a mass murderer and you ask for forgiveness on your deathbed, I mean, he said because it's ultimate justice. But it's not justice because it's perverted, because if you repent, you don't go to hell. And if you're a murder victim and you don't believe in Jesus, well, now you're going to hell. I mean, that, there's no sense in justice there. It's an injustice. It's a perversion of justice. Then there's the problem of evil, where a lot of bad things happen. And this is the problem of evil because it's a philosophical problem, because they say Jesus is all loving, all knowing, all powerful. And yet, here's a tsunami in 2004 in the Indian Ocean that killed hundreds of thousands of people and displaced millions of people. And the Bible says Jesus holds all things together. So here Jesus held together this tsunami, because it wouldn't exist without him holding it together. So why is Jesus killing a couple hundred thousand people and displacing millions? All that pain and suffering. So these are conflicts with this ancient theology in the Bible, with what we know now with modern science. You know, I mean, obviously, from a naturalistic viewpoint, the tsunami is just a matter of tectonic plates. But the ancient theology says, oh, Jesus holds everything together and Jesus does everything. Another thing I wanted to bring out is that animals, there's animal studies and they show that they show rudimentary signs of justice. You know, there's one YouTube video where these monkeys are perfectly happy getting cucumbers, but when one sees the other monkey getting a grape, he throws the cucumber back in a fit. That's kind of funny. One final thing is, you know, a lot of atheists say good without God. I just want to say that's not really, that kind of bothers me a little bit, because it's not the same good. I mean, it implies that, oh, Christians are good and we can be good without God too. But the thing is there are different kinds of good. For example, a Catholic would say birth control is bad, is evil. And I would say, no, it's just opposite. Birth control is very empowering to women, and it's a very good thing to do family planning like that. So it's not the same good whatsoever. And I would suggest maybe instead of good without God, maybe we could say we're gooder without God, or better without God or something. So anyway, I think the solution is just accept that the natural world is all there is and everything will make sense. And I'm sorry I went over time there, Ben, but I'll make it up to you.
Was that a moral failure?
Yes, yes.
Was that an objective?
Lord, have mercy on my soul.